está bien poner el escritorio.
¿El qué?
Déjalo en el escritorio.
Thank you everybody for coming. We are honored to have Cesar Aira and Heather here. Before introducing the event, I want to talk to you about an initiative we have here. We are starting a fund for families in the process of deportation, or they have members in the process of deportation. We are doing that for Spanish events or Spanish translations. Why we are doing this? Because we understand that we have a Spanish market here, a translation industry here, we have an academy in Spanish, because all these people that have been coming into the country illegally for generations. Because of them, we can have a Spanish section over there. We can have Cesar Aira here selling the books in Spanish. And we have been doing this for 10, 12 years. And now things have changed. I mean, with the past administration, they were bad, but now it's worse. You know? We have a population, a part of the population that has been is hunted down, has been targeted for the new policies, and it's not just bad hombres, you know, it's just mothers and fathers that they have been deported, and mostly they are Spanish-speaking people. Those people are our public, our customers, our market, and the children of those people are the ones who start reading Cesar Aira in English and then start reading Cesar Aira in Spanish. I mean, for us, it's very difficult to just keep doing events, just a regular business, like nothing happened. And maybe in Queens or 10 blocks from here, Asian from ICE, they are taking families, they are taking mothers away, fathers away. So I think it's more important than just post something on Facebook or do a tweet about this. Just gather money and send the money. We are sending $1,000 that we got in March to the Senora Trujillo, that is a mother of four American citizens that have been deported yesterday. You can Google it, Miss Trujillo, a Mexican. She has been deported yesterday and she left four kids here in the country. She has been in the country for 15 years. The only crime, she has an illegal ID to work. It was the only crime. So that's why we are asking publishers for $100 collaboration that when we do the events. And we are asking the public just to collaborate to donate. We want to get $2,000 in April to send to two families. Okay? Thank you very much. I'm going to pass the box, like in the church or AA meetings, but whatever you can collaborate is great, guys. Thank you. I know this darkens the mood a little, but I think is we feel better doing events after we do this, and that doing events like nothing happened and without doing anything for this people. You can look on Facebook in America's Voice. Is Maribel Trujillo has been deported yesterday. Now, the event. Cesar Aira, Argentinian writer, I have known him for years. Second time they here in the store. Thank you very much, Cesar, for coming again. Cesar Aira was born in Coronel Pringles in Argentina in 1949 and has lived in Buenos Aires since 1967. He taught at the University of Buenos Aires about Copy and Rimbaud and at the University of Rosario con Rostovich and Mallarmé, and has translated and edited books from France, England, Italy, Brazil, Spain, Mexico, and Venezuela. Perhaps one of the most prolific writers in Argentina, and certainly one of the most talked about in Latin America, Aira has published more than 80 books to date in Argentina, Mexico, Colombia, Venezuela, Chile, Spain, and has been translated for France, Great Britain, Italy, Brazil, Portugal, Greece, Austria, Romania, Russia, and one novel, La Prueba, has been made into a film, and How I Became a Nun was chosen as one of the Argentinians' 10 best books. Besides essays and novels, Aira writes regularly for the Spanish newspaper El País. In 1996, he received the Guggenheim Scholarship. In 2002, he was shortlisted for the Romulo Gallegos Prize and has been shortlisted for the Man Booker International Prize. Today we have some of the backlist, and we have the last book. Little Buddhist monk and the book. Thank you, Heather Clary. I forgot to tell that also we know Latin American literature because some translators here, they got engaged to Argentinian writers, but also because of the immigrants that they came here. And congratulations to you, both. Heather Clary. Heather Clary. Is a translator that whose translations include Sergio's The Effects, The Planets, and The Dark, in open letter books, and a selection of Liberio Girondo's poetry for New Directions. She teaches at Sarah Lawrence College and has served as a judge for the BTBA and the Penn Translation Award. She's a founding member of the Cedilia and Cop Company Translator Collective and founding editor of the digital bilingual Buenos Aires Review. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Let's stand up.
Thank you, Barbara and Mika, for the invitation to speak with Cesar Aira today. It's a tremendous honor. Thank you also for publishing these books. Thank you for bringing him into English, because, you know, though I started reading Aira's work in Spanish, it's such a tremendous joy to see how his work has caught on in English, and to be able to talk about these wonderful books with my colleagues and friends who don't speak Spanish. So that's a tremendous gift that you've given to us, and thank you. And thank you, I guess, I suppose, as well. So Javier was very thorough in his introduction, kind of underscoring the vast production that we have enjoyed from Cesar Aira, not only in fiction, which I suppose is sort of the favorite form, ranging from books of 20 pages published in cartonera editions, kind of handmade cardboard book objects, all the way up to kind of longer works with larger mainstream publishers in Spanish, but has also produced quite a lot of literary criticism as well, the 600-page volume, a dictionary of Latin American writers. These are the things we don't often hear about, but a really broad and varied and thoughtful body of work that has really inspired so much rich conversation in Spanish and in English. So I think I kind of, speaking of sort of inspiration, wanted to start with one of the other reasons you're here in town, aside from launching this wonderful dual book that we'll be talking about at length this evening, was also a project that you're doing with MoMA, which seems very fitting because the visual arts are also, they seem to play an important role for you.
Well, yes. Yes, the MoMA had a project of make something, valise. Seven Latin American artists made works inspired on a book of mine. And well, they invited me here, and I was in the MoMA these days, and it was interesting experience to be in the entrails of this monster. Yes, I don't know what to say. Maybe that's this book that inspired this artist, an episode in the life of the landscape painter, was maybe the only book I wrote about a painter. Nothing. I am, of course, much interested, yes, I use the painting as an inspiration, as a stimulus, and yes, I see how much more avant-garde is the art, the contemporary art, than literature. thing you do in the sense of breaking the models or breaking the structures, go to a, how do you say, callejón sin salida.
Like a dead end.
A dead end, yes. For example, this concrete poets, Brazilian mm. concrete poets made a constellation of wars.
Mm.
Yes, very nice, but this has no continuity. From this you can't go on.
Mm.
Literature has a stone wall
mm.
that you can't pass because it works with meaning. So any avant-garde ends there.
Mm.
And but you can.
And yet you can.
Yes.
Well, this kind of makes me think a little bit about your process. I mean, as many of you probably already know, Aida is known for this technique, the la huida hacia adelante, no? The constant flight forward, which in many ways seems almost like a Dadaist operation, right? Collecting ideas as they come, incorporating them into a whole that seems improvised and yet follows a logic. Perhaps.
Well, I had a very bad ear for the foreign languages. Even if I read very well English, I read even the Finnegan's Wake without trouble. But I don't understand the taxi driver or the waiter. And the advantage of this is that when they make me a question, I do not understand, so I can answer anything I want.
Bueno, tenemos dos opciones.
Yes. What do you want to ask?
Bueno, la pregunta sería como si hay una influencia quizás dadaísta o del surrealismo en tu procedimiento, como la huida hacia adelante, si viene a...
Yes, well, yes, I still am. On these avant-garde, historic avant-garde, the futurism, Dadaism, surrealism. Avant-garde has two meanings, I think. One is this historic thing that happened in the first decades of the 20th century and go on being a stimulus for me, at least. And the other one is the going a step ahead of... Here, I think that there are two kinds of people, of writers, or critics, or readers. One that thinks that literature is an eternal thing, that Shakespeare or Homer did all that you can do. And there are others that say that literature is an historical thing that can go on transforming, mutating. I am of this second class. I think that literature can renovate and and my work is looking for ways of saying something new. Not exactly saying, writing something new, doing something different. And my avant-garde is an avant-garde of the content, not of the form. My form is strictly academic, simple, I don't know how to This, I have made a comparison.
Comparison?
Yes, with Dali. Believe it or not. Because, I see, Dali had an enormous imagination, visual imagination of monster things. So he needed an academic, classic form. If he wanted to make an elephant with the legs of a mosquito, he couldn't do it in the, as an abstract expressionist. He had to do exactly like Raphael would have made it. And so, leaving aside the genius, it's my process. I have an volcanic imagination, so I need a classic form, because volcanic and volcanic would be a mess.
Impossible to follow.
Yes.
Yeah, very true. I think someone described it as the contact between sort of hyper-realism in the clarity of the prose and the way you focus on detail, and surrealism in the sort of events as they unfold in the narrative. I wish I could remember who that was.
Yes, well, Dali is a good example. I love Dali. Because he was one of the very few people who could say this strange phrase, I am a genius. I tried to write an essay about this. What means the man who say, I am a genius? Because when you say, I am a genius, you mean I could make the function the microwave or something. So, but to say it in the real sense and to base all your life on this phrase, that was the last time I was here, someone made me see the difference between genius and genie. A genie is the one that came out of the bottle. It's different, but there is a connection.
Dali was certainly known to do that from time to time, just pop out. So I think I have a very mundane, kind of boring question, but I want to ask it. Sobre tu proceso, I'm going to do the question first in Spanish and then repeat it in English. sobre tu proceso y cómo escribes, esta huida hacia adelante parece requerir mucha concentración para seguir el hilo. O sea, hay una lógica muy fuerte en cada narrativa. Voy a terminar la pregunta y después puedes responder a cualquier elemento. Pero a veces trabajas múltiples narrativas múltiples a la vez, o seguís uno solo y después. So the question was simply whether he works on multiple projects at once, or whether he kind of in this constant process of writing focuses on one and then moves to another.
No, I do one at a time. Because when you begin, the thing goes by almost by itself, and this I have seen many times that I come to a dead end. I don't know what to do, or even I see that the page that I wrote this day is not, it's not good, but then come something that I think this literature, the lady, the literature come and arrange everything. Yes. I love literature for this generosity that she has with me, that even not being a very intelligent man or very talented man, she does think, I don't know exactly why and how, but she does. And I'm very grateful for this. It's the process of writing, for me, is a very physical process of writing in manuscript, in drawing every word with my pen. And I have never could plan a thing of the reading. Sometimes I have an idea, but it's very diffuse. But when I'm reading, I'm reading. I am a writer only when I'm reading, writing. How is your pronoun? Reading or writing?
Writing.
Writing. Yes. Yes, sometimes I have not an idea, I have not nothing in my mind, but I begin. And then it happens. Yes, I am not very happy with what I have written, in my life. But maybe every writer is not satisfied with the things he has done. And now I'm 68, I almost am an old man. I can enter in the museum saying, senior.
Important to MoMA.
Yes. And I have begun to observe not that I am not as good as I was. And it would be a good moment to stop writing.
No!
But no, I won't. No, I have decided to enjoy my decadence.
Right. Excellent. There is this wonderful, so we're here tonight ostensibly to celebrate the release of the newest book, which is actually two texts. I shy away from calling them novels because you've said so many things about novels and the ways in which your work.
In Spanish, I use the word novelita.
Novelitas. So we have two novelitas here.
Two novelitas.
In Nick Kaster's translation. So you have quite a team of translators working for you in English.
Well, my, how could I say, official translator is Chris Andrews, an Australian poet. That is a genius. He better my books incredibly. Yes. For example, the previous to this, the Emma Rodiva, Emma the Captive. I saw all the critics that my publisher sent me, and everyone talk of the magnificence of the prose. But yes, misappressions because he lived in Argentina, but he lived in Argentina in a hippie community.
I understand, I understand your reservations.
No, but he's a good boy.
Well, he did have a beautiful turn of phrase. This is actually one of my favorite lines that I've read in a while. It comes within a larger explanation of things, but I think the phrase I just want to pull out, in every artist, this is from the Little Buddhist Monk, in every artist there's a remnant of childhood, not assimilated into the adult personality, like a seahorse in a human-shaped tank. Which I just thought was such a fantastic description of the artist's sensibility. And I almost want to ask what that remnant is for you, but I feel like that might be a dangerous question. Pero tenés ese, o sea, ese resto de la juventud que decías que todo artista tiene como algo que le queda de la juventud, de la niñez, que nunca se asimila de todo. Con el ser adulto.
Oh, yes, I have a. I don't know. Yes, maybe. Yes, I have a childish disposition of mind. And for example, in this book that is Bob Spock and all this thing, I was very influenced by a cartoon. I don't know if you remember it, Rem and Stimpy.
Rem and Stimpy. of course, major part of my childhood.
Yes, I was very much influenced, and I put one scene that I take literally from Rem and Stimpy when the horse want to suicide or to hide.
At the top of the pagoda.
Yes.
That was from Ren and Stimpy.
Yes. Maybe you think, how imaginative is I? Yes.
You just have the TV going in the background.
Yes, maybe there was another influence, a little more culture. There is a picture of Magritte, of a rhinoceros mounted in a Greek column. Maybe I have Ren and Stimpy and Magritte.
That may be a good, I'm hoping to have plenty of time for questions because I'm sure that many of you probably have burning questions, so get them ready, there will be a moment for that. But I'd like to talk about these two books that are just coming out right now. Would you tell us a little bit about the two stories, or if you want to do one at a time, we can talk about the Little Buddhist Monk.
Yes, I think the proof was very previous. The proof is the 1989, and the Little Buddhist Monk is post Ren and Stimpy. Yes. The proof was this years of the 80s in Buenos Aires was there. After the military process and the democracy and openness, there was many things that I am a paterfamilias, a petit bourgeois. I have nothing to see with this world of youth, but I saw the punks and the girls who loved girls and the boys who loved boys. I saw it from a distance as the old bourgeois that I am, and I wanted to frustration, and I wrote this stupid book. Yes, I saw it from outside, so it's almost a joke.
Well, it's a joke with a very serious punchline.
Yes, well, I thought in this the proof of love. What can I say to you who believe that I love you? And these two punk girls to demonstrate his love to this young Virgin. They take a supermarket, they kill all the clients and the cashiers and they
there's immolation.
When they made the movie, I have a great disillusion.
I was very disappointed.
Yes, very disappointed, because the proof was still a taxi.
That's a real letdown if you read the book.
Much more easy to film than to make the great catastrophe hecatombic in the supermarket. I have had more than one disappointment in this sense. For example, once I wrote a theater piece. It's called Mother and Son. It's my mother and myself talking. And then my mother is factual. I transcribed my conversation with my mother in Pringles. Then my mother goes to the kitchen to prepare the dinner. She found that the frozen chicken takes life. And it grows to a monster chicken. And the three times that the beast was misunderstood, I couldn't see the chicken.
No.
The chicken. Yes, because they spent the lights, it was all sound, or they put the.
Cowards.
Yes. I would have loved to see this chicken. Yes, that's why I do not like to do things. My son is a professional drawer of comics, and he always is asking me to make a script. Even me and my son, and besides, he specializes in four things that are extraterrestrials, mutants, extraterrestrials, zombies, and Nazis. And sometimes,
at the same time, together?
No, sometimes Nazi zombies. But I wrote a novel of zombies.
You did. And your mother, right? Your mother, this time not the chicken,
dinner.
But the
yes,
zombies.
Yes, yes, yes.
She writes as well, no?
My mother died last year, 91, and she was a very extravagant woman. She wrote, she had a novel, a book that she read 150 times, that was Wuthering Heights of Emily Bronte. And when she wrote her own autobiography, knowing nothing of literature, of these extravagances of young writers, she made intertextuality, because she made a wuthering hate of his life. Mm-hmm. Yes, but it was not very good.
Well, I suppose perhaps we could move from a giant chicken to a tiny monk. Is that same?
A tiny monk, yes. Yes, it's also, as most of what I write, based on facts. Once I was in Paris, and my publisher there made me meet a couple, man and wife, or photographers, French photographers, that recently came from Korea doing photos of Buddhist monasteries. These kind of photos that are 360. And we were talking, and they told me about the experience there. I changed the names, of course. He was
yes, you did.
Napoleon Chirac.
Napoleon Chirac.
She was Rosemary Vladimir. No,
Vladimir. See,
Vladimir.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. And I invented the little Buddhist monk. Yes. My son, that is a reader very strict of my books, he read a book of mine and asked me, what have you been smoking this time? No, I have the hallucinogens incorporated from Earth. Tell me that he reread this, looking for the size of the Buddhist monk, because it can be, it's little, but
not clearly defined.
No, not clearly defined. At the end, you discover that he was Bob's monk.
But it is important that he is smaller than all the other monks, because Napoleon Chirac is very, he guards very jealously the idea that he has the smallest monk as his guide. That's very important to him. Did you want to read a little bit from the text, or do we
want
to... What would you like?
Yeah.
Shall we read a little bit and then we can have questions?
Sure.
Yes.
Okay, good. The part of the...
Yes,
the part at the end?
That is the same,
Would you like this one?
Because
it's bigger, yeah.
Because I have not my lunettes for breathing. Give me the end.
Yeah, I'm just opening it right now. Here's the last chapter.
Well, this is when night had fallen, the little Buddhist monk made the guide of this couple of photographers all day, and well, at last the photographers go away, and the Buddhist and the little Buddhist rest alone, and he want to go home, and he want urgently come to his home, because of, you see why, getting to home and getting there quickly wasn't the second to lose. Time was taking its revenge, all the magical suspension of the moment that he had used to enchant the French couple were dissolving, leaving only an inflexible and unavoidable horizon. Between him and home lay a forest that he had to cross on foot. He was not afraid of getting lost. Fear did not even enter in his mind, because he knew it from memory and could not get lost if he wanted to, even in complete darkness, and it would doubtless be on this occasion. But darkness was never complete for him, because his own body, or possibly its movement, gave off a glow. In reality, he was not thinking of the forest of the dark or the darkness. His thoughts were limited with absolute insistence to the goal of his journey, his home. He might have said, and would have done, had there been anyone to talk to, "My home is my castle," and his home was pure light. The correct term, yes, his home was pure light, because he's an element of the TV. The correct term would have been little home, because of how small and empty it was. In his home, there was literally nothing apart from a television set that was always on at night. It was the light from the screen, from that screen, intensified by his sense of urgency that was guiding him, just as a shooting star had guided the shepherds of Mith. In his troubled imagination, it became pure light, an endless, saving regard. In fact, it was the television that was the reason for his urgency. At 10 o'clock sharp, the moment after the end of children's scheduling, was signaled, and some cute little dolls, packed the children off to bed with a lullaby, a program he could not miss was due to begin. He had been waiting weeks for it. And that very morning, when he went out, it had been uppermost in his mind, to the extent that, even though it was only 9 o'clock, he told himself he would just go out for a walk and get a bit of fresh air and then come back quickly, so that he would not miss a minute of the program. How do you say, program or show?
Program.
However, the adventure with the French couple had intervened, and now he was in a dreadful hurry. Well, no use crying over the spilled milk. He didn't waste time lamenting or allow self-recrimination to paralyze him. He was already in the forest, frantically moving his tiny legs along what he hoped was the straightest line. He knew that a 1,000-league journey started with one step and was taking all the steps he could. He weaved in and out of the trees, escaped the bushes, searched the firm support of the roots, shutting above ground to launch himself forward, always forward. He stumbled and fell, and sometimes rolled over, but nothing could stop him. His one thought was to arrive, to get there in time. He could even calculate whether he would arrive, because he had no idea. He couldn't even calculate whether he would arrive, because he had no idea how long it took to cross the forest. Although he had often done so, he had never timed himself. Besides, he had no idea what time it was. He did have a wristwatch, but could not see it in the darkness. He tried raising his arm almost up to his face and attempted to make sure the feeble glow he gave off lit the minuscule dial, but he couldn't see a thing and didn't want to waste any more time. So he lowered his arm and set off even more rapidly than before, a little farther on, and his curiosity got the better of him. He attempted a second time to make out the position of one watch hand. It seemed to him there was only one. Were they on top of each other, making it 10 to 10? But then he thought he could see three hands, or 12, or none at all. The only thing he could be certain was of was that time kept passing inexorably by, and it would soon be 10 o'clock if it wasn't that already. And he was filled with a boundless anxiety at the thought that he might miss the program, or worse still, that he was missing it at that very moment, because they weren't nothing to wait. They weren't going to wait for him to show it at 10 o'clock sharp. It wasn't just another program. He had a reason to consider it so important. It had been trailed for weeks, from the moment he heard about it, along with many millions more Koreans. He had been on tenter hooks, waiting for the day and time of its transmission. The program involved an incredible novelty, the result of recent advances in design and animation technology. The happy combination of a team of doctors, artists, and computer with skills has succeeded in creating a model of the female sexual organs. For the first time in history, this had allowed the exact location of the clitoris to be identified. It was not that existence of this tiny pleasure spot or its position had been unknown, but the man in the street, the average husband or lover, still had difficulties finding it. This was due to the confusion produced by verbal descriptions of it, a confusion never resolved by the drawings of books illustrating these descriptions. On the contrary, it was the drawings that had ended up making the difficulty impenetrable. The two-dimensional representations had all the well-known limitations, but this became insurmountable when it came to the complex empty volumes of the external area of the female reproductive organs. It did not help that humans had evolved from standing on four legs to becoming bipeds, which means these volumes were in a position that conventional drawing could not properly depict. The solid three-dimensional models that pedagogical ingenuity had come up with, besides being hidden in university lectures, theaters, or anatomical museums, had been too small and hard to manipulate to fulfill their function. Until now, nobody had imagined that the ideal medium for bringing the good news to the public was television. The 3D animation, digitalized and driven by a specially developed program, instantly resolved all the problems of comprehension. TV viewers could take a virtual stroll through the first interior or exterior interior, which, with all its nooks and crannies, its superimposed concavities and convexities, by identifying with the eye of the camera, they could finally orient themselves and discover once and for all where this elusive little phantom was to be found. And the Korean people were to have the privilege of being the first to know. Conscious of the importance of the sexual pleasure in life, the little Buddhist monk had waited impatiently for the transmission. The contemporary passion for television had finally found an object worthy of the eagerness with which the program was anticipated. Recalling his own expectation was like being wounded by an arrow of time in the depths of the dark night and made him even more anxious. There was no way he could miss it. To him, it was life or death, a life or death affair, and he refused to consider whether he was behaving like a child. Wasn't this, on the contrary, the most adult thing that had ever happened in his life? And there was no question of waiting for the repeat, because there wouldn't be one. The producer had been through a lot just to get permission for this screening. The legal battle had lasted for months, and even now have not been finally resolved. The transmission was going ahead thanks to an injunction that could still be appealed against, and as a defiant gesture of now or never. The next day, the Korean newspaper will be full of indignant readers' letters from the usual reactionaries, and the scandal would put so much pressure on the judges that it would be banned forever. Besides, nobody would call for it to be repeated. Why would they, if they had already discovered what they were after? A predictable psychological reaction would come into play. Those who already knew the secret, the past, to the hidden object, would not want the others to discover it. It did not matter that tens of millions of viewers would have seen the program. The unique quality of the occasion made the revelation invaluable. They would rub their hands gleefully, telling themselves anyone who missed it has missed it forever. They would be able to gloat at their superiority over this year of virtual losers. And the losers could well be real, as perfectly real as he himself would be if he did not arrive in time. Had he reached the center of the forest, he had no way of knowing, etc. I won't read the last two pages that are the nightmare properly.
Hello. My question is, I've read a lot of your books, and I love them. And one thing I love about them is, I feel like often on the one side, you are often can get very analytical and very intellectual and explore very abstract concepts on the one side, but also they're so funny, and I feel a lot of melodrama also in them, of a melodramatic plotline. And I was curious if you had thoughts of why you like to play with, if you think about those two things, or why you like to play with very intellectual ideas and very funny melodramatic stories.
Yes, maybe these are the two sides of my mind. I don't know. In fact, I can't explain many things of what I do because it's mostly intuitive, it's mostly improvised. And yes, I see this intervention in the story, in the narrative, there comes an idea, a pseudo-philosophical idea, and it's there. And I thought many times that this was... I shouldn't do that. The narrative should be narrative without the intervention of ideas or theories or fake theories. So I did the experiment of doing a book of ideas. A book, no narrative, a book of ideas. I called it Continuación de Ideas Diversas, Continuation of Diverse Ideas. And all my friends said, no, this doesn't go. Your ideas function in the narrative. Don't be outside of it. So they are not amused. I am not a muse. We are not a muse, it's the Queen Victoria. Yes, no, I thought many times that it was an error, a fault to have this. Well, there is another thing interrupting the narrative that are what in English is called purple patches. Mm-hmm. Now people don't know what are the purple patches because of this Carver and these people that have not purple patches. Purple patches are the poetic descriptions that interrupt the narrative, and I think that purple patches are fundamental in the novel, in the narrative in general, because the purple patches is a triumph of the language, is a poetry of the language. It's difficult to explain, but it's not exactly the purple patch, this poetic description that interrupts the action. It's not exactly the purple patch per se, but what gives a purple patch?
Leads to.
Yes. So the narrative that has purple patches is a narrative that goes to the poetry, to another thing than just the action. Many times I have thought that the illuminations of Rambo, Les Illuminations, are purple patches. And someone should write the novel interspersing all the illuminations. If you have no.
Another question?
You've got excellent plans. Well, thank you. I'm very interested in your literature in general, but also cartoons, and I found very attractive this idea of a writer using cartoon structures for writing. And I know also that you have written about Kobe, who was, before being a writer, was a cartoonist. So I would like to ask you, please continue, talking about the relationship, the relation between fictional structures, literature, and cartoons.
Well, my main influence in my childhood, in my first youth, was the Superman. But the Superman of the 50s, what is now called the El Hombre Plata.
The Golden Age.
No golden.
Silver Age.
Yes. This was incredible. And I'm so sorry that children now have not these wonderful cartoons, because Superman was one, Little Lulu was the other, but that's another story. Superman was a very intellectual cartoon, and it was very intellectual because of the premises. Superman had all the powers, was almost a god. He could travel in 6 seconds to Andromeda, he could anything. So, how create a conflict with a man that could do it? They had to invent Lex Luthor, of course, and genius. And the genius was the script writer of this, because it's incredibly difficult example with the kryptonite. There was three kinds of kryptonite. Green kryptonite that debilitated Superman. Red kryptonite that was wonderful, that produced imprevisible reactions in Superman. For example, he began to tell jokes. Anything. And the gold kryptonite that destroyed his powers definitively. So you have to have many precaution with the gold kryptonite. And with this, and for example, the mixipitilix. Mixipitilix was a little genie that lived in the fifth dimension. And sometimes he could enter in our dimension. And he was a catastrophic, even if he was a little thing. And the only way you can make Mr. Mixipitilix go back to his prison in the fifth dimension was make that he said his name upside down.
Backward.
And Superman always found the way to say that he pronounced his name. And many things like that. It was, so I passed from his games of Superman to Borges. In one step. Because I loved it, and I deplore the cartoons of today, the manga, and all the thing, and the thing that my son draws for yours. Publishing houses for Marvel and DC Comics that terrorize in the third world the work of followers like my son, but they pay it well. And with the zombies, mutants, extraterrestrials, Nazis. No, we had another thing. And then, well, I loved the French cartoon, of course, Tintin, Tintin of Hergé. When I discovered Hergé very lately, it was a great discovery for me because of the narrative elegance of Hergé. It's almost like who has this kind of elegance in the narrative. Woody Allen, for example, in some of his movies, not all, or Almodóvar, this kind of fluence on, and the colors, whatnot. And of course, Crumb, Robert Crumb, that is a great family of mine.
Do we have time for another question or two?
Yes,
of course.
One more.
Yes, Kino has one of the most incredible drawings that are two drawings. In the first, a lady said to his that make order in a room that were having a party. So, and in the wall there is a big reproduction of Guernica. And in the second drawing, the lady comes again, and the work is done. All is perfectly ordered. And the Guernica is ordered. Only Kino who
The question in the back.
Good evening. Thank you for your presentation. I was wondering if you could say more about your ideas on writing as a physical act, or maybe something about writing as a ritualized process that we go through, or maybe as a meditation. Thank you.
Yes, it's a physical. Well, I'm a militant of the manuscript writing. I think that we are losing very much for losing the manuscript writing. I think that manuscript writing is the basis of our civilization, and we are losing it. I saw when I went to a cafe to write, I write in the cafes always with my good pen. And I see many times someone working with a notebook, a telephone, a tablet, and in a moment he needs to take out something and call the waiter to have a it's a shame. Yes, because there is a work of nervous system when you write that is it's like the Koreans. If all the rest of the world is going to be idiot, I'm gonna be more intelligent than them.
Hang on to the secret.
Yes.
Good. I think we might need to wrap it up unless there's one last quick question. But I think we're reaching our time limit for the evening. Okay, one last one, or no?
There is, okay, last one.
Sorry, the one, yes, go ahead.
Hi, I just wanted to ask you about your writing technique. I've heard, whether if it is a myth or it's really your own writing technique, that you do not do any rewriting. You just write the whole book and you go back and check your sentences, because most writers spend most of their time rewriting, but it doesn't seem to be your way. So can you give us a little light about that?
Yes, I think there are two kinds of writers. In fact, there are 1,000 kinds of writers, but there are the ones that make a sketch and all the libido, all the pleasure is in the rewriting, in the reformulating, in the polishing. And there are others that write definitive, as if they go to die tonight. And I am of this second class, not because I am afraid of dying tonight, but yes, I write so slowly, and as I said, drawing every word that is, when it's written, is the best I can do. So what more can I do? There is some danger there in thinking that, yes, you do the best that you can do, and then come Borges, and it's the intervention of ghost, of imaginary, of an imaginary element that is going to make better what you have made. You do what you do. Now, with time, I'm much more, much less confident. I don't know why exactly, if it's because I do not write as well as before, or I'm more ambitious or more afraid, but when I wrote my first books, they were, yes, maybe I cheated with myself because I wrote the book and then I leave it some time, some months, then I took the manuscript and I read it and I said, it's wonderful.
Well, I think that's a wonderful note. The wonderful book we have in our hands tonight just came out, and it's available here. Thank you so much for the conversation. It was really a pleasure to talk with you, and thank you all for coming. And I guess there are books for sale.
Yes. Give us a minute, Gary. We are sit there. Gonna send new directions, Heather again and Cesar again, and everybody for coming, also for collaborating with the Anti-Deportation Fund. And we have the book to sell, you know, this book is gonna be out in May, so it's gonna be here 1 month before you can get it. And also we have backlist and books in Spanish. Thank you everybody.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. No, no, it's not.